Hello, everyone. Thank you for tuning in to today's session. We hope you're having a great time at this very unique AU experience. Welcome to our live webcast, Strategies to Drive Technology Adoption with Tara Verdia, Customer Success Manager at Eagle Point. My name is Tiffany Willard. I'm a Global Business Development Specialist, and I will be your moderator for today's session. Before we get started, I'd like to cover just a few housekeeping items. This webcast will be recorded for replay purposes. It will be provided to you after the session. We're going to leave some time at the end, excuse me, for Tara. So feel free to submit your questions at any point throughout the presentation by typing your question in the Q&A box. If you are having any technical issues, let us know. Somebody's going to be available to troubleshoot there with you. Also, everyone is muted and will remain muted throughout the webcast. So again, if you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A box below. As far as our agenda, what you can expect today is we're going to get started with introductions. I'll give a brief explanation of who Eagle Point Software is. I'll turn things over to Tara, and of course, we'll wrap things up with Q&A. Now I'd like to introduce to you Tara. Tara Verdia is our presenter, and for more than 6 years, she has been building authentic relationships with her customers, learning about their challenges, and developing proactive strategies to help them achieve their goals. She is passionate about helping others believe in the ability to be agile and innovative, and those are two qualities essential for growth, especially in the technology space that is entrenched with rapid and continuous change. As for me, my name is Tiffany Willard, Business Development Specialist. Again, I joined the Eagle Point team back in 2009, and it has been an absolute pleasure seeing Pinnacle Series grow in adoption, not only here in the Americas, but globally. My area of expertise is talking with individuals who are responsible for driving digital transformation on the front end of our sales cycle. So whether your organization is small, mid-size, or large enterprise, everyone experiences the same pain points Pinnacle Series is designed to solve. So let's talk real quickly about Eagle Point. We've had a long-standing history in the AEC market. John Beaver, our president and CEO, started the company believing that there had to be a better way to leverage technology to do things faster and produce exceptional work. As time has moved on, our product offerings have changed, but our vision has not. In 2006, Pinnacle Series came to market, and Pinnacle Series is a leading e-learning system designed specifically for companies in the AEC space, including manufacturing. Today, we have over 200,000 global users. We're also one of the founding members of the Autodesk Developer Network, and we're also an Autodesk authorized publisher, and we're very honored to be part of that elite group. I'll wrap up by mentioning that we have a growing network of Pinnacle Series resellers worldwide. And with all that being said, I will turn it over to the lady of the hour, Ms. Tara Verdia.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Tiffany. Appreciate it. So in my role at Eagle Point Software as a customer success manager, I am very fortunate to get to work with a lot of really just professional and intelligent individuals across the AEC space. Part of that really stemmed from, working with how to develop training plans, how to solve some of those common challenges that Tiffany referred to. And recently I did a talk with Andy Schrader from WSP and Greg Grana from HNTB. So as a result of that, that's kind of why we're here today. Just wanted to summarize that discussion and give a little bit more detail from my perspective as a customer success manager to really help you be able to either implement a technology strategy, or if you already have an existing one, be able to really refine and optimize that to maximize the benefits that you're going to get there. So starting off here, I think it's really important we hear digital transformation. That's almost in every single conversation I have with customers is around digital transformation. There's organizations that are trying to achieve that, and what are those steps that they need to take to get there? And so that's also really the core of why we're here together today. So just want to kind of run through some of the drivers of digital transformation, which leads to where we're going to end up as we really get into things. So digital transformation has several different drivers, which you can see there on the screen. The first one of digital innovation is the ability to use technology to improve existing business processes and to improve efficiency, also to elevate the customer experience. So it's really a push to utilize technology in a way that you're able to solve the problems that you face day to day. This then leads to digital disruption. So that's transformation that's caused by new technology impacting how we currently do things. It also creates competitiveness across the market and really pushes people to move towards a new way of doing things. That then leads into digital adoption. So this is really the spot where we're going to be focusing in on today. But digital adoption is it occurs when people can successfully and fully master the technology that they have access to. This is going to lead to carrying out digital processes that achieve specific outcomes or a specific purpose. The unfortunate part of this is that the average person is only using about 40% of a technology's feature. So that's really where we start to get into the importance of training. So we'll talk a little bit more about that, but I want to talk a little bit more about digital adoption here. So digital adoption, it does require an understanding of the digital processes to successfully leverage the technology that you're using. And digital adoption also has an important role in driving change. So it's kind of a loop in order to achieve that digital transformation. It's not just a linear progression in one direction. It continues to repeat itself. And it also requires an organization to restructure its internal processes and effectively respond to that digital disruption. So how do we do that? Really, we have to have a mindset change. So as the technology that we're working with is changing and how we work each day is also rapidly changing, in order to achieve that digital transformation, we really need to be willing to explore new ways of doing things. We need to be willing to embrace change, and we need to also be visionary in what we're doing every day with our processes and how we're leveraging technology. So as that technology is changing, so are our processes for using and maximizing the technology, taking us from digital innovation into digital disruption. This is then going to cause a skill shift. So this is going to impact how we upskill and reskill, how we train. So our training needs to include fundamental knowledge, but it also has to include applied knowledge for all of these new digital processes that are coming about as we go through this entire transformation. So that's really the core of the importance of training. Training is really, really critical for digital adoption to be successful, and that is really an integral part of digital transformation. So I just wanted to kind of talk about some of the previous training methods, current training methods that we use today. We at Eagle Point really believe in a blended approach. It is not just about e-learning. It is also about still having that mentoring, still having that human interaction. So with that, providing the fundamental training, so more so on a macro learning scale, where you're given the big picture, a series of concepts that you're expected to understand. But then there's also the micro learning, which focuses on how to achieve a specific skill and then be able to take that and apply that immediately. So that's why we really believe in a blended approach, that it's absolutely necessary for any sort of training to be successful. It really requires a training modality mix for those users that are going through that training program. So the industry, we've kind of talked a little bit about some of the challenges. Tiffany mentioned those, but I want to kind of call attention to some of those specifically that I hear day to day when talking with customers. So across the screen there, one of the biggest and probably the biggest challenge is resistance to change. By nature, as human beings, we are just resistant to change. It causes us discomfort, fear, stress. We worry over the unknown. It also disrupts our daily routines. So naturally, we are very hesitant to embrace change with open arms. The next one there is disconnected leadership. And I don't want that to sound too negative, but what I mean by that is many times the alignment between senior leadership and frontline leaders can be off, which causes a disconnect. So if you think about maybe as a child, you played the telephone game where I whisper a message to you, you whisper a message to the person next to you, and that repeats on down the chain until the final recipient receives that message. At that point in time, it is most likely a breakdown of communication that is occurring in which there's very integral pieces of information that are missing. So this can be from the top down, or it can be from the down to the top. And it's just, you know, something that happens where humans, mistakes occur. So when I say disconnected leadership, I don't mean that in a negative way. It's just something that naturally happens. So we really need to be able to get ahead of that and address that. Another one that we really struggle with here is continuous update. So, you know, as our technology is changing, that is going to, of course, require a lot of updates. So, you know, this could be anything from just hot fixes that are coming out to an entire new version of technology is coming our way. This then is a point that becomes a struggle sometimes for our IT teams, those responsible for maintaining an organization's technology, because there's some frustration around having to continuously push out those updates. And that tends to stall out our adoption of the latest technology and really prevents us from embracing that change and being innovators in our space. The last one there is outdated processes. So as can be expected, as that technology is changing, our processes are also going to change. So we need to make sure that we are on top of that and that we are keeping those up to date. Part of the really important piece of training is not only around that fundamental knowledge, but as I mentioned, it is applying that knowledge on the processes that users are going to be doing day to day in order to do their work. And that really relies on up-to-date standards, up-to-date processes. So that's a really, really important part, but it's also a really big struggle for many organizations. So we talked a little bit about the common challenges, really dove into those a little bit, but let's talk about the value behind training. So why is training so important? Digital adoption requires effective training so that when users are trained, your business is gaining a competitive advantage and you're essentially realizing an increased return on your investment for your software and your technology within your organization. Training is also related to the three P's, and those are proficiency, performance, and productivity. Proficiency is going to drive performance, which in turn is going to drive productivity across your organization. If you have well-trained employees and they're productive employees, you're going to start to see a higher rate of performance. There's going to be improvements across the organization, and it's going to, of course, impact your organizational performance. And that is going to lead to an increase in agility, innovation, and effectiveness as an organization. So training is really, really valuable when it comes to positively impacting your employees across the three P's, but also their employee experience. So as an employee, if I get onboarded and it's a really good experience, you're going to immediately start to see an increase in my engagement. You know, I'm going to want to be present. I'm going to want to do better, be better. That is going to then lead to retention. And ultimately, employee performance through engagement and retention is going to impact your ability to successfully recruit new individuals coming on board. So just keeping in mind, our human capital is really our greatest asset, and training is absolutely integral for developing and maintaining that asset across our organization. So a lot of times you're out there and you're thinking about what really goes into a successful training solution. So each individual organization is unique in the sense that, you know, you do have your own challenges. But again, there are some of those common challenges. And I think when you're looking at a successful solution for training, some of the main checkboxes that you should be considering is, you know, is this going to help me be able to onboard my staff more quickly and efficiently? Is it something that is intuitive and organized? It's easy to use. People want to go there. It's, you know, user friendly. Does it offer training that is both individual or is it role-based training? So you need a combination of the two. There's certain information that we as employees need to know. So that's, you know, across the board, you know, if I'm coming into a certain department, what are those foundational concepts that I need to master? But in addition to that, there's also the concept of being able to train on your role, as well as being able to do professional development. So anything that's personalized. With that, training does need to be targeted, and the solution that you're looking at should also be targeted and the ability to deliver personalized training. Another important thing that I kind of alluded to a little bit ago was the importance of updating your standards. getting that out in front of users, giving them accessibility to that, making sure that they know where to go for that. So your training solutions should also be able to incorporate the ability to knowledge capture and share. So, you know, taking all of that wonderful organizational knowledge that you have and being able to distribute that out across your users in a really easy way. The last one that's really, really important that comes up very often for customers that I work with is the ability to customize. So this includes not only being able to leverage the out-of-the-box content, but also being able to customize that content and deliver that so that users have access to content that really talks about their internal best practices and processes, and they can leverage that to just build upon that foundational knowledge. So let's talk about some of the recommendations really that I would want to give you. There's three key recommendations that I would encourage you to consider when developing and implementing a technology adoption strategy to drive digital adoption. The first one here is by far number one. If you do not get buy-in from your organization, anything that you do as far as training, your technology adoption strategy, it is not going to be successful. So this is an absolutely critical step to implement any technology adoption strategy. The buy-in needs to be from the top down, and it needs to be at all levels of your organization. So the strategy that you're presenting should be presented in a way that aligns with organizational goals, and it also aligns with the vision of your leadership. As you're working on getting buy-in, you also should be able to incorporate goals for other levels of the organization, or at the very least, be able to demonstrate how this is going to be beneficial to those folks and use data to support your conversation whenever possible. We are visual creatures, and you know, we can talk numbers, but if you can actually visualize that through data, it's really just going to help solidify that case and help you get that buy-in. Another really important step with buy-in is to consider any potential barriers that you may face. So that is most likely going to come up in some of those conversations, and it's best to get ahead of that and develop solutions for overcoming those barriers so that you can present those ahead of time, and that is really going to help get buy-in when you're having those conversations. The next one here is communicate. Communication is also extremely important, so over-communicate. Communicate frequently and also with all levels of the organization. We should be mindful of framing our conversation in a way that is appropriate and relatable for our receiving audience. So also being mindful of a communication timeline. This is going to involve change, and no one likes a surprise when it comes to change. So the impact that it's going to have on our day-to-day routines, you know, just being respectful of others and understanding you may have known this is coming for a while. You know, you've been thinking about it for a few years. You've been working on it diligently for a few months, having some conversations. But what about others in your organization that are going to be impacted? You know, they don't need to find out that, you know, everything's going to be flipped upside down. Things are changing. Their routine's going to be upset. And you give them 3 days notice. That's just not going to go over too well. So, you know, be willing to communicate with all levels of your organization and use it as an opportunity for employee engagement. Incorporate feedback, be willing to listen. And if you do get any questions or concerns, you know, be prompt with responding to those and make sure that people feel heard, because that's going to be really important. That's an essential part of communication. It's not just talking to people, it is about listening to people. So, you know, change is scary. Just lay it all out there clearly, you know, message who, what, where, when, why, and how. You know, that's going to really help people be able to wrap their minds around the change that's coming, understand the impact and the value that this change is going to bring to them over time. So the last one here that I would really recommend is when you're looking to do a technology adoption strategy and you're looking to push training across your organization, it's important to wrap that up into your organizational culture. You know, refine that organizational culture and convey it through your company values. Training should be a part of your culture. And why it should be a part of your culture is what I had mentioned earlier. Our human capital is our greatest asset. We need to invest in people. And if people are well-trained, they are going to want to do better, be better. We're going to have a better chance of retention, recruitment. So there's so many different positives. And so integrating that into your culture is really, really important. Some other things that really help with driving training and getting that as something that's part of your organizational culture is to embrace change as a positive. I know that sounds pretty easy, you know, just embrace it. But, you know, it's really a mindset. You know, it's that mindset shift of, you know, change is going to happen. There's nothing that we can do about change. if we do not adapt, we are going to be left behind and we are not going to be successful. You know, everybody's going to pass us by and we are going to fail at being industry leaders. So embrace change as a positive. It's something that's good. You know, it's going to bring a lot of benefit for the organization and for the people that are part of that organization. Also, that is, you know, kind of tying into promoting a change ready attitude. You know, always be ready for change. You know, don't be complacent. You know, don't get comfortable in some of, you know, old habits. Be willing to be flexible and move beyond your comfort zone. The other part of that is to be pro-learning. I understand in the industry that we work in, a lot of times it's very, very difficult to provide overhead time for training. You know, we want everybody to be billable. At the end of the day, it's about making money. So it's very difficult at times to have conversations around the value of providing that training time. But you know, if we have a culture of being pro-learning, that really opens up the door and it helps us understand, you know, in order to make money, in order to have work going out the door that is of high quality, it's consistent, you know, there's not a lot of rework, there's not a lot of ping-ponging back and forth through the processes, people need to be effectively trained in order for that to happen. You know, it's not just something that's going to happen osmosis. You know, you really do need to invest in that and be willing to collaborate with others. You know, listening again to others across your organization, what's working, what's not working, and just be willing to work with others and be open to suggestions and recommendations across the organization. Because as we are going through change, it's going to be consistent and it's going to be continuous. So collaboration is a really important piece for being able to move things forward, keep things fresh, positive, and to really help your organization be successful. So the last one here, I want to talk about the implementation journey. So, you know, part of my role is to work with customers on implementing our solution, the Pinnacle Series. And, you know, there's really five main areas that we talk about when we talk about the implementation journey. You know, it is going to be full of curves. It's going to be full of hills. You know, there's going to be good times. There's going to be bad times. But there's really the five key areas that we talk about. The first one is to set goals. If you're not able to define your end goal and you really do not know what you're trying to achieve, you're not really going to be successful with developing a strategy. It's just not going to work for you. So you do need to be able to identify what is our goal, where are we trying to get to, and then that's going to allow you to build that strategy and have those steps for getting to that end goal. The other really important one is to measure progress. So some of the ways that we see customers measuring progress is looking at the onboarding time. You know, are you becoming more efficient with onboarding? Is it taking less time to get people up to speed? You know, are they getting the skills that they need? Are they getting to work on projects much more quickly? Another area that is measurable is a user's proficiency with the technology that they're using. We happen to be partners with KnowledgeSmart. They're an industry leader in AEC assessments, absolutely wonderful company based out of the UK. Their assessments are really to identify skills and where those skills lie within individuals across project teams. And it's a combination of both theoretical and practical questions. So you're going to be assessed on common concepts and terminology, but you're also given downloadable data sets to work through and prove your proficiency. So there are methods for measuring proficiency and finding out where those skills lie, and then being able to track progress over time across your users and to see if they are adopting the technology and if they're moving beyond that 40% usage of adoption and really expanding that broad, the bandwidth and the breadth of which they're adopting the technology that they're using. The other thing is to identify problems. So, you know, this is, again, it's going to be a challenge. There's going to be things that come up that maybe we didn't expect. You know, I said earlier to identify barriers. Well, you can do the best you can, but there's always going to be things that come up and you just didn't consider them and you didn't account for them. So identify those and also address them immediately. Don't wait it out, you know, think it's going to fix itself. Let's see how it goes. That's really setting yourself up for disappointment and essentially really taking away from your opportunity to be successful. So when you do start to see problems arise, you know, why are people not going through their training? You know, that's why do we not have time? Why, when we agreed upon, you know, giving X amount of hours per month for training, are they not being used? Identify those and address those immediately, because that's really going to help you keep going forward on your implementation journey. The last two here, so being flexible. So because this is around change, it is a process. We're working with lots of different people. You need to be flexible, and your strategy needs to be able to be adjusted. And this is a journey. So as I mentioned when we first got started on this slide, there are going to be curves, there's going to be hills. And with that, just being able to adjust that strategy and being flexible. The last one is really just have lots of coffee, sleep, and repeat. You know, this is, again, it's a journey. There's going to be a need to reevaluate your strategy along the way. And maybe you've reached your destination. Maybe you achieved those goals that you had set out to achieve in the beginning. But it doesn't just end there, because once you achieve those goals, you then need to go back and repeat that entire process around new goals and really optimize that strategy. Because again, we are in an environment where I think right now I would say that probably what's happening with the technology that we're using, BIM 360, this is like revolutionary innovation happening. It is rapid. It is constant, you know, and in order to stay ahead of that, or at least try to stay aligned with that, we need to be able to adjust our strategy, rinse and repeat over time. And so this is some of the conversations we have during implementation. You know, it's really about what's going to set the stage for you to be most successful, and the importance of training. Because if you do want to achieve digital transformation, that is going to require a really successful training plan, training solution. And it's going to require a team. You know, this is not a solo person thing. It's going to require buy-in from the top down across your organization, and for you to be committed to pushing this change, because at the end of the day, it's going to really move you forward as an industry leader. So I hope you found this to be beneficial. If you guys do have questions, definitely encourage you to post those in the chat box. I would love to be able to answer any questions you have. And at this point, I'm going to turn it back over to Tiffany.
Okay, awesome, Tara. That was a phenomenal presentation. Yeah, we do actually have a couple questions that have come in. So we'll go ahead and start with, do you have any recommendations for KPIs for measuring the effectiveness of technology adoption strategy?
Yeah, so I think that would kind of tie back into measure progress on this slide here. Some of those are looking at, you know, how long it takes to get somebody up to speed, you know. Are we still seeing that be a slow process? Are we seeing people struggle? Being able to take a look at that onboarding effectiveness and the speed at which people are getting up and running. You know, being able to measure skill sets. So, you know, one of the questions is, where do I start? I don't even know where to start with training. But the ability to give a skills assessment using a platform like KnowledgeSmart, that is measurable. That is absolutely measurable, because you can get a baseline of those skill sets, have somebody go through training, you know, have them go through several months of training, and have it be mixed training, that blended learning approach between the e-learning, the live training, whatever makes sense for your organization. And, you know, 6 months to a year from now, measure that again, put that user through another skills assessment and see if there was any progress. You know, did they expand out their breadth of adoption for the technology? And that's a really amazing way to be able to measure that. Also being able to take a look at productivity. You know, how long did it take somebody to complete a specific task pre and post training? That's another really good way to measure, you know, how users are doing. And the last one would really be performance. So that could be anything from individual, team, or organizational performance, being able to measure, you know, those improvements over time.
Okay, great. So here's another comment and question. So great points, Tara. Do you help organizations create all this change discussed? And how can I begin How can I begin assessing what change is needed and who are important people to work with initially to make the change a success? This sounds like a lot of work for one person to oversee.
Oh, that's a great question. So let's see. You know, I wouldn't say it's a lot of work. It's a journey again. And that journey is going to have its ups and downs. It does require buy-in across the organization. So, you know, I would definitely not say to one single person, you know, take this on. You can definitely be the champion and spearhead the change. You know, having a positive attitude like that is going to go a long way. But this does require getting buy-in and support from others within the organization. And in order to move that change forward, that is also going to be integral because, you know, again, one person is not going to really be successful with pushing some of these changes across the way. Part of my role is to have some of these conversations. You know, some individuals and organizations are more open to these conversations, others not so much, and that's okay. You know, some of these are, we have this conversation right out of the gate from the very beginning. Other customers that I work with, this is something that I get little bits and pieces. You know, as we develop relationships, we start to talk about challenges. And really to know where to start and what needs to be changed, I would start high level and identify some of those most common challenges that you're facing. You know, is it that you have different office locations working different ways? If that's the case, then I would start there. How do we get all of our offices standardized? What are the steps that we can take? You know, chunk it out, do baby steps. You know, it doesn't have to be all at one time written out and addressed. If you start high level and work your way down, that's just going to make it easier for you. So I would definitely say getting other people on board, you know, you can definitely champion, but it's really a team effort. It's an organizational effort. And that's why I had said that mind shift change and that culture change is really critical for understanding the value and the importance of training. But not only that, you know, I've been sitting on in a couple of sessions from some of my customers and hearing about the challenges of standardizing processes. Part of training is, of course, again, around the fundamentals. You know, how do I use this technology? But the other part of that is really critical for how we work day to day is how to apply that. And that's really incorporated through our internal best practices and processes. And so that's really a sticking point for a lot of organizations as well, is standardization and making that easily accessible. So, you know, if you do have any further questions or, you know, want to know some tips on where to get started, reach out to me and let me know. I would love to have that conversation with you.
Yeah, that's definitely a big conversation. Thank you for that question. Thank you, Tara. So here we have another question. What is the most common challenges you hear from customers that prevent them from implementing a successful training program?
Yeah, so I think that kind of ties into everything we've talked about. You know, we do have people that set out with really good intentions. You know, they're fired up, they're passionate, they're ready to just, you know, lead the cavalry forward. But they forget that it does require that buy-in. It does require that communication. And because it is around change, the communication does need to be frequent, you know, to the point of over-communicating until things become ingrained in our habit. And so there's a lack of communication. You know, one message that something's coming is not enough. Two messages, you know, one that it's coming, one that it's here. That's not enough either. And so I think that it really falls down to a lack of buy-in and then also a lack of communication. It's really important as you are progressing through this to communicate your progress. And that is at different levels, you know, and it's, again, tailoring that message to your audience. So the conversation that you might be having with senior leadership, most likely that conversation is going to be looked at through a money lens. That's what's really important to that audience. Now, if you're talking about somebody that is working on projects, not so much. You know, they're talking about, you know, how easy is this for me? You know, what is my day-to-day work life going to be looking like through these changes? So being able to reframe your conversation and deliver the appropriate message to the appropriate audience, that sometimes just kind of falls through the cracks through no fault of anyone's. But that's also something during implementation that the customer success team at Eagle Point Software, we really focus in on that. We So not only is it the technical side, so implementation clearly is, you know, implementing a solution, so our technology for training, but also the biggest part of my role is really on the people side. So focusing in on how to support organizations with these challenges, making sure that they have taken into consideration the need for buy-in, the need for communicating, and that we're not just whipping change around on end users with no advance notice whatsoever.
Okay, great. Looks like we have another question coming in on training. It's difficult to know where employees' skills fall. How can I most easily determine employees' skill levels and use it as a starting point for developing a training strategy?
Yeah, so that also kind of circles back around to Knowledge Smart, being able to use those skills assessments. And, you know, when we say the word assessment, sometimes HR is like, no, we're not going to assess our employees. That's just not part of our culture. Also, when employees hear the word assessment, they think, oh my gosh, we're back in school. You know, they get scared of taking a test. They think that their job's going to be impacted. They're going to be judged. And so really the positioning, again, tying that into communication, but the skills assessments are really great because they do identify skills gaps. And that's what's really important, because a lot of times we put people through training and they might already know 70% of that information. That is a waste of your time as an organization, as well as that user's time. So not really making good use of our training time, which is really hard to come by. In general. So the assessments give you a very clear picture of where those skills gaps lie across individuals, across teams, and then allow you to develop targeted training. With that, one of my favorite things about our platform, Pinnacle Series, is that we do have an integration with the Knowledge Smart platform, and that integration allows us to take the assessment results and really apply personalized training. So pulling out all of the training concepts and material that is not relevant, the user's already proven that they're proficient with that particular area, and just providing them with content that's really personalized and targeted for what they need to learn. So I would definitely say assessments, you know, and just making sure that when you are talking about assessments, the positioning and framing of that is really, really important, because this is not a tool to, you know, determine whether somebody should get the boot or if they are, you know, a valuable employee. It's really for you to be able to identify where those skills lie and then provide training that is effective and efficient and that it's going to be successful for those users.
Awesome. Thanks, Tara. So I think we're going to go ahead and wrap things up. It's the last question that we have, but I do want to say that as questions do come in, don't hesitate to reach out to Tara. Her contact information is listed at our booth, and then we'll also flip over to, I think maybe our next slide, where we're going to have some things that you don't want to miss, but as we're pulling that up, actually, Tara, one more question just came in and we can get to the next slide. But hi, Tara. Tiffany, I wanted to comment regarding the assessments. I found that integrating Pinnacle Series into our company, I'm getting positive assessment involvement for using, let's see, hold on one second. Okay, I'm getting positive assessment involvement for users since Pinnacle Series enables users to sign up on their own. So really just more of a statement there. So thank you for that reinforcement that Pinnacle Series and the assessment is really driving user adoption and training. So, all right. So don't miss Tara's complete session. She had a chance to sit down with two of our customers, H&TB and WSP, and really talk about how they have two very unique, very distinct strategies for implementation. You know, I loved, Tara, in your session, how you are right here, how you talked about there's so many twists and turns and ups and downs, and there's so many ways to approach it, and there's not just one right way. So I think if you attend that session, you'll get to hear directly from those clients how they're approaching things. And again, as questions pop up, don't hesitate to reach out to Tara. Tomorrow, we are going to have our final live thought leadership webcast here at our booth. We're going to be featuring Mike Ivanhoff. Mike's one of our content team leaders, and he's going to be focusing on how e-learning impacts digital transformation. So you're not going to want to miss that. Finally, I just want to thank you guys for attending. We're so happy to be here at Autodesk University this year. Don't hesitate to reach out to myself if you're actually interested in learning more about Pinnacle Series. I'd love to set up a call with you and talk one-on-one and exploring the possibilities of Pinnacle Series and what it holds for your organization. We are also offering a free 30-day trial. So reach out to me to figure out how you can get signed up for that. We appreciate your time today. We hope that you enjoy the rest of the conference.